Good evening, viewers. On behalf of Sakra World Hospital, I would like to wish you all a happy Lohri, Makar Sankranti, and of course, Posh Parva, and Bogari Bihu, and a happy Pongal. Because of our various diversities and different states, each of our states celebrates this festival in their own culture. And I also like to wish you all a happy New Year. With this, I would like to welcome Dr. Rajendra, Senior Consultant of Plastic and Reconstruction Department. Doctor, with this, can you please introduce the topic that we are going to talk about?
Good evening, all the viewers, and happy Sankranti and Pongal. Today, we are talking about abnormal head shapes in children. How important is early diagnosis of this condition? Having a abnormal head in a children's is a very common condition. Most of the parents ignore that. Even some of the health professionals, they ignore this condition. Before understanding the abnormal head shapes, it is important to know how is a normal head shape is there and how normal skull looks like. Usually the head is one third more longer than the width, and it is more circular in the back side. And usually the skull, this is one of the skull model, it has various bones, and usually there is a gap between these bones. These are called the sutures, which are a growth plates also, which helps in an expansion of the skull, and which allows the brain growth when it is growing. Whenever there is a fusion of this, it causes a restriction of the skull expansion, at the same time bone growth. So the abnormal shapes may be of a different types, whether it may be a triangular shape in the front, or it is a more longer than the width, or it is more height in the vertical direction, or it is flattened in the front side also. So the causes of this abnormal head shape are due to various causes, from the simple positional effect to the early fusion of the sutures, like these growth plates. When it is abnormal head shape is due to positional, like a child lying in a particular position, only one position, they develop abnormal head shapes. This is called a deformational plagiocephaly, and nothing to worry about that. These are easily treatable. You have to just turn the baby in other position in the resting time, and in very severe and rarely we have to use a helmet, which helps in molding the skull. Then other commonest cause is a usually these are sutures which usually fuse after 22 to 30 years. When it fuse by birth, it causes a restriction of the skull expansion and at the same time brain development. So this is called a craniosynostosis, where cranium means a skull and the synostosis of fusion. Due to this, the patient will present with a various head shapes depending on the which sutures are fused.
And doctor, I've seen that some newborn babies have a small, a putty. You know, people actually from households, like they say grandmother's recipes, they tie something to their head so that it does not have an abnormal growth. So how effective is that?
If there is no fusion of the skull bone, the sutures, that will work. And also changing the position. Whenever there is a fusion of these sutures, these all remedies may not work.
So a couple of questions by our viewers. They want to know what is the meaning and what is an abnormal shape of a head? How do you define that a head is abnormal?
Yeah. Already explained, the head should be a round shape. And it is one third little longer in the anterior position, front to back side, than the width. Whenever when you see other head abnormal shapes are like a, you can see this is a there is a fusion of a suture, like this is called a metopic suture. A patient presents with the triangular shape, it's
yes.
called a trigonocephaly, and in this you can see there is a fusion of the fusion of the side sutures. The patient is present with a flat head,
okay.
and sometimes fusion of this center sutures causes a long heads. So, and also sometimes what happens, fusion of a multiple sutures causes a small head. So these are various shapes depending on which sutures are fused.
And most of the time, all can lead to abnormality when they grow up.
Yeah. So even if a single suture also fused, it causes an abnormality with regard to the shape of the head also. At the same time, it affects the bone brain growth.
Okay.
Over the long run, they have an effect on the brain development, memory, and speech.
And then another question. How craniosynostosis affects the child?
Yes. So whenever when they are open, brain grows rapidly within the first 1 to 2 years. During this time, the sutures should be open so that it is allows the brain to grow. And so whenever there is a fusion of particular suture, that part is a restrictive part. So that won't allow the brain to grow. So that causes a at the same time other sutures are open, so brain start growing in that direction. So skull is also grows in that particular direction.
Yes.
So
yes.
So in that way they will start producing a different shapes, and at the same time this affects the associated facial deformities also.
Yes.
Whenever there is this is the first part. So and whenever there is a restriction of the skull growth restriction, so there's the pressure builds up inside the skull. It's called an increased intracranial pressure.
Okay.
So this has a secondary effects on the brain growth and the development. So it affects the brain memory, long-term motor functions and speech. It has a lot of effects, and also whenever a significantly increase in intracranial pressure, it affects on the eye and sometime vision also.
And is this condition genetic?
Yes. This is whenever there is a craniosynostosis associated with other deformities, congenital deformities like facial deformities, like a decreased growth of a midface.
Yes.
So it causes and also associated hand deformities. In these cases, there is a most of the times it is genetic. Otherwise. Without genetic predisposition also happens. It is around 60% without genetic, but even still 35-40% of the times it is a genetic disorder. Whenever a genetic, it is associated with other disorders of the heart and midface deformities.
Another interesting question: how craniosynostosis child presents, and how do you diagnose such condition?
Yes. So we already discussed the obvious sign what we can see is a abnormal shapes.
Yes.
It may be a triangular shape, it may be the long face, long head, or it may be increased in the vertical directions. This is very commonly seen presentation, and also you can see these are normally gaps seen in the child. These are called the soft spots. In these children, we don't feel these soft spots. This is also one of the sign. Also, we can see these are ridges.
Okay.
These are hard ridges. When we feel in the child with the craniosynostosis, we can see feel these ridges on the whichever suture is fused, and along with that they present with a mental issues like abnormal brain development, memory problems, speech problems, and in the long run motor functions also. And also sometimes they present with fits or seizures, and sometimes airway issues also. And this is clinically, and we usually diagnose with a clinical examination and a history. And we confirm by taking a CT scan, which it shows which suture is fused and how is the head shape. Yeah.
Yes.
And also it shows a thin bone. If a pressure is inside the brain is increased,
yes.
it shows a bone is very thin. Yes.
And how do you treat the condition?
This treatment is multidisciplinary because it is involved brain and skull. So it is treated by the plastic surgeon, craniofacial surgeon, neurosurgeon. Very important. Almost most 50% of the work is the neurosurgeon, we have to have a ophthalmic consultations, ENT doctor, orthodontist. They develop changes in the teeth and other things,
yes.
Aligning other things, and we should have a speech therapist.
Okay.
So all this is a multidisciplinary
approach. Yes.
So all these in departments are very important in the final treatment. The main usual it requires a surgical management.
Yes.
Surgery involved depending on a what type of which suture is fused.
Okay.
And the age of a presentation, when they present, which age, like early, within 3 months, 6 months, within a year, depending on that, the treatment depends. So when the child is present within the first 6 months or within 3 months of time,
mm-hmm.
So what we do is it's called a minimally invasive endoscopic or endoscopic assisted craniostenosis correction, where it usually is done for a single, only one suture is fused or a two suture is fused. So where we make a small cut in the wherever there are sutures, either front or in the center.
Yes.
Through that we put a endoscopic, is also called keyhole surgery. So where we put an endoscope,
mm-hmm.
and whichever suture is fused, whichever part of a bone is fused, we'll remove that part. So we are removing the restrictive, whichever is restricting the brain growth or a skull growth.
Yes.
We remove that. So which helps in a expansion of the skull, at the same time allows the brain to grow.
Mm-hmm.
And this which is followed by we immediately put on a helmet.
Yes.
Helmet. So what it does is it guides the brain skull growth so that we can get a proper shape. So usually these helmets are given for 1 to 2 years after surgery, and these are made or planned very meticulously with a scanner and with the use of a CT scan, so that it gives a proper shape. So the advantage of this, we as a SACRA, as a pioneer in this minimally invasive surgery, because only India, only we are the SACRA only doing all these endoscopic surgeries for a craniostenosis. And the advantage of this minimally invasive is, so when we are doing a very small cut,
yes.
so the recovery is very quicker, and the surgical time is very less, hospital stay is very less, by this the faster recovery. At the same time, we are addressing the problem with this addressing the problem is very early stage.
Yes.
Like, so that we are preventing or reducing the further complication related to the craniostenosis.
Yes.
Like increased intracranial pressure or eye changes, brain changes. And when a patient presents after 6 months of age, so during that time what happens, the bone very thick, and also there is lot of, by the time, by 6 months or 8 months, usually a lot of changes will happen in the skull bone.
Yes.
So we cannot treat at that stage with minimally invasive procedure. Then we offer them a open surgery.
Okay.
And this open surgery is called frontoorbital cranial molding.
Okay.
Or a cranial cranioplasty. So where in this is usually done when a child is relatively older, like around 10 months to 1 year, so that anesthesia purpose is also, they are very safe, and also it is easy to handle the bones at that age. And in that surgery, what we do is we just cut up from here to this ear to ear. So we open the skull, front part of a skull, and we take out the skull bone and remodel, so reshape according to the proper shaping, and we fix it with some plate and screws which are absorbable, it's got a biodegradable.
Okay.
Plate and screws which absorb over the time of a few months time, so that they don't have any metal inside the skull. Yeah. So and this is a little this open surgery is it takes a little longer time compared to the minimally invasive, and the hospital stay also usually it's little longer than the longer than the thing, and the blood loss and other things are much more than the endoscopic procedures.
And how safe is the surgery when you have such a long recovery period, and this is a very, it sounds like a complex surgery. So when it is such a complex surgery, people would obviously hesitate. So how would you recommend to go about it, and how safe is the surgery?
Yeah, any surgery is a risk, but we at Sakra, we have a very good multidisciplinary approach. We have a very good neuro anesthesia, pediatric anesthesias, and we have backup of a very good in neonatal or intensive care unit. So doing surgery in such an environment is always safe, and it gives a good results. Okay, yeah. So we are doing from very long time, so without much of a complications. Yeah.
And there's another question, doctor. What happens if this condition is not treated and left unattended? Then what would happen?
Yes, yeah, that's a very important question. So whenever there is a if you don't treat the condition, there's a restriction to the brain growth, and the skull won't allow a brain to grow. It has a secondary effects on a brain development. So also brain won't grow, and it has effects with regard to the milestones, developmental milestones, and memory issues, and their speech is also affected, and sometimes their motor functions, and they become very weak, they can't move some parts of the thing. And some cases, if it's very severe cases, if not treated, we have seen a reports of a deaths also in such cases. So it's always better to diagnose these things and treat it appropriately.
And that too at early stage.
Yes. It's early stage.
And there's another question. What is the importance of detecting the condition early, and why should we detect the condition early?
Yes, we have already discussed. This is very important because we have seen patients coming at 3 years, 5 years, where they have already developed a secondary complications of these conditions, like they go into mental retardation, or a few patients have a problems with the vision. So it is always better to diagnose it early, so that we can treat it and prevent the secondary complications. So yeah,
that's very important because
disease progresses, it causes a lot of effects on the skull. Even if they come very late, if the changes happens, which are irreversible, because whatever happens to the brain, it is not reversible like any other tissues. So always once damage to brain, always a death. So there will be a deficit. So that is the reason why we insist is to treat it early, so that we can prevent a secondary complication related to the brain stenosis.
Another question is that can this condition be detected when the mother is carrying the child in the womb?
It's very difficult. Many a times we have all the mothers who have these conditions, the child's of them. So everybody has undergone the scan. It is very rarely we can detect the condition.
And post-birth, like immediately after birth, is it again detectable, or we need to wait for another 3 months?
If it is obvious, we can detect it. But if we take a CT scan, if you are suspecting immediately after that, if you take a CT scan, we definitely will come to know that. So it's all dependent. But first, by 3 months time, definitely we can just see some changes in the head shape. If they are very alert, and if they come to if they show to a doctor who is treating them, either a pediatrician or a neurosurgeon or a neurologist, so if they diagnose and confirm with the CT scan, first 1 to 2 months, sometimes they think it is a positional, because the child is lying in one position.
Yes.
So they generally the general perception is like that.
They will automatically assume that. Yes.
Yeah. So it's always better than the ignoring the thing. So if nothing is there, it's well and good. If something is there, we are in the early stage, or we are stage where we can treat it and prevent the secondary complications.
So thank you, doctor.
Thank you.
With this, we conclude today's FB live session on craniosynostosis. So stay tuned. We'll come back next week with yet again another interesting episode. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, all the viewers.